The following is a presentation from the MJCast, the internet's premier podcast on all things Michael Jackson.
You're listening to the MJCast, by MJ fans, for MJ fans.
The idea is to innovate, or else why am I doing it?
When I create my music, I feel like an instrument of nature.
You let it create itself, really. I know I do.
And I love to entertain. That's one of my favorite things. Simply Michael Jackson.
Welcome to the MJCast, your source of news and discussion on the King of Pop.
Welcome to the MJCast. I am Q and I'm here with my co-host Jamin Bull and a special guest host Jankins of another great Michael Jackson podcast that I love, Moonwalk Talks. Today we have the honor of talking with someone who worked in the studio with Michael Jackson, indeed on some of the fan community's favorite MJ tracks.
That is right. We are here with none other than CJ DeVillar, bassist and mix engineer. CJ has had the honor of working with artists such as Quincy Jones, Boyz II Men, Glenn Tipton, Ray J, Van Halen, P. Diddy, Ice Cube, Pharrell and the Neptunes, one of my favorites, NSYNC, and of course, the legendary King of Pop, Michael Jackson.
We're so honored to have CJ here today with us to share some stories on his career, how the stars aligned for him to meet and work with Michael Jackson, and yes, we'll get to hear about moments around CJ in the studio with MJ. CJ, it's a pleasure to have you here joining us on the MJCast. Welcome.
Well, thank you so much, fellas. It's a pleasure to be here. I like talking about Michael. It's a lot of fun.
Oh, it's really exciting for us. Anytime we get a chance to speak with someone who worked in the studio with the King of Pop, it's just a great honor.
It's always fun for me too. I get to share with some of my friends who are able to sometimes too. So
we've heard you're quite the storyteller from a friend of ours, Damien Shields. So we're looking forward to this.
You actually featured in his book, didn't you? Escape Origins, I think.
Yeah, he gave me a nice little write up in there. I think he enjoyed our chat. And I liked how we put it down. You know, when you tell a story, especially about Michael Jackson, you're not really sure how it's going to end up in print. And Damon did a really wonderful job. I was very happy with it.
Yeah, he's a great guy.
Ain't that the truth?
Yeah.
So where are you Skyping in from? You're in the U.S., right?
Yes, I'm in Manhattan Beach, California right now.
Great. So we're pretty much all over the world. Q and I are from Australia, obviously.
Yeah, that's far away.
Yeah. So we might actually kick things off now with some of our questions, and we love starting things by getting to know sort of the early stories of our guests. So would you be able to take us back sort of to your childhood? Talk to us about where you grew up and what sort of childhood you had.
I grew up in Orange County, California, very close to Los Angeles, or people would consider it part of Los Angeles. But I lived not too far from Disneyland and Knott's Berry Farm and all those places. And typical suburban neighborhood. That was it. My first early music memories would be the Beatles. That pretty much, it annihilated me when I was 6 years old. I didn't know what was going on with my head and the sound that was going on that they were making. But that pretty much kicked off my early years. And then, of course, the radio got me into Michael. So I was hearing all the early tracks all over the radio during the 60s. I'm 55. So I'm just a couple years younger than Michael. So we kind of grew up same era. So the music, the radio, that's what got me first for Michael.
So how did you like originally get into a part of where you wanted to create music?
Well, really, I was, a few piano lessons and a few guitar lessons through my life sort of got me interested in it. I never really took off with it. I always sort of dabbled. And then I ended up in a few after high school sort of, you know, noisy bands. And then I ended up answering an ad in the paper for you musicians. You know, just someone just writing in saying, hey, we need a bass player. I answered it. And went and played bass with them, and in about a year, I had a record deal on Epic CBS, which was actually the same label at the time as Michael or the Jacksons, I think.
Yeah.
And so I got involved with bands around about 20 years old, and that was kind of the early part of that.
You mentioned that you were at this time listening to some of, you know, Michael's music and the Jacksons' music. What songs in particular were you really getting into at that time?
Wow. You know, it was just the hits. I was funny with music, and my parents weren't real big promoters of music. So I was kind of left to my own accord. So I really just sort of ran into music. I didn't have a whole lot of records. So I was constantly just chasing down radios. And so really all the input I had from culture was strictly from the radio. So for Michael music, it was all the hits.
Like Don't Stop Till You Get Enough and that sort of thing.
That stuff. Yeah, you know, and it was just killing me. And I just loved hearing that stuff. And all the way through Dancing Machine. And, of course, watching the television all the time, all the variety shows, the Jacksons were everywhere, all over television during the 70s. So you didn't have to go after them. They were everywhere as far as my time and my culture was concerned. The Jacksons were all over the place.
And when you like listen to the music that you love, be it the Jacksons or anyone, was it the sort of instruments or the production that sort of drew you in, that you were sort of trying to get into and dissect a little bit more?
No, I wasn't overthinking it at all. I was just going, yeah, that's awesome. I don't want to hear that again. And that's, I still listen that way. I consider myself I don't like technical things in music. I may be kind of a weird engineer, but I always tried to take the technology out of making music. I always kind of felt that's why Michael liked what I did. I wasn't fussing around with all the boxes so much, you know?
Absolutely. And he's quoted many, many times in his books and things saying exactly that, saying get out of the way of the music and just let it create itself.
Yeah. So I wasn't the type of engineer that was like, I love these buttons and I like this piece of gear. And to me, they were just tools that had to work very quickly so I can forget about them. And I knew he was that way. And many artists are that way. But really kind of inexperienced engineers are all about the gear. Anybody who's made records, it's all about, the moment and getting intensity and getting energy. But I forgot your question.
That's all right. So, like, I can see that you've played bass on a range of sort of tracks with many, many artists. Was the bass, the bass guitar, the first instrument that you were attracted to, or how did that sort of start out when you were first getting into it, other than like answering that ad? Was there any other instruments?
Well, I play a little bit of guitar, I play a little bit of keys, but I really am kind of a cheater. You know, I understand how computers, and Pro Tools and all the cool audio software. So I can make a whole record and play all the instruments as long as I'm able to edit the crap out of myself. I can do pretty good. But a bass I can pick up and play and get along with most bands. So, and that started out of high school, and I just sort of dabbled for a while. I didn't get serious until my first band, and that was about 1983. I got serious playing around then.
What kind of band was it?
My first band, we were like Duran Duran. Our hair was huge and our clothes were
nice.
Our clothes were beautiful, and you know, and we wore makeup. We were totally androgynous. And we had a record deal on CBS, and that was my first band. And we made a record and we toured. We opened up for Cyndi Lauper and a bunch of other things. And and then we were on the same label as the Jacksons during the Jackson Victory Tour. So there was some cross-label people involved. So we knew his manager and his manager knew us, things like that. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
I've got one. Is that when you had the really like big blonde hair?
Yes.
I saw that picture just before. I was like, that is a cool look. That is 80s awesome.
Man, it a lot of people love that a lot because the 80s are coming back for a lot of people. They love it, but it's just complete hilarity for my nephews. So they really like they because they're in bands too, you know, but they're in punk rock bands, so it really doesn't quite mix. So they don't get the 80s. It looks like the 50s to them as far as we're concerned.
Everything funny. Comes back around.
It right, good. So I'm glad it's cool. Thank you for saying that.
Thank God. My God, it's awesome stuff. I love the hairband 80s sound as well, the 80s hairband metal. I love all that sound as well.
I get a lot of calls like, do you have any more of your records left? Do you have any more of your tapes, CDs? People write me and they want me to send them T-shirts and posters. I have none of it. I've given it all away, but I still get calls for it. So I'm a little surprised. There's a bit of an undercurrent out there for old material from the 80s and things like that. It's kind of a mind blower for me.
What was your band called, sorry, at that point?
The band was called Bang Bang.
Bang Bang. Awesome. We'll have to get some stuff and put it in the show notes. Is it on iTunes?
I don't think it's available anywhere. This was like being put out on CD in 1984 was like you had to be like 5 million seller to get a CD back then. Only Madonna and Michael Jackson got CDs, you know. So we were vinyl.
Yeah.
Cassette. So anything vinyl and cassette really doesn't have much play on the internet. So we just on the cusp of that time. We just kind of missed the digital upload thing. So you won't find much out there. My sister has an album somewhere, you know.
Yeah.
But you might find something. It's pretty rare.
So what actually happened with your band? Did you guys, like, how come, did you guys break up or what happened with that near the end?
Well, we got politically hammered by the label. Frank DeLeo was Michael's manager, and a guy named Larry Larson was the brothers' manager. So Larry was managing the brothers, and Frank was managing Michael on the Victory Tour. And those two, Larry and Frank, they were at odds with each other managerial-wise. So that tour really didn't end up making them friends. It made them like mortal enemies, I think, at one point. We were on Epic CBS, and so was the Jacksons record. So Frank took it upon himself to be a real pain in the ass and to show Larry that he didn't have much pull, and he pretty much crushed our record at the label, and they were just over with us. It was that old story you hear about the label infighting and bands getting shelved. That's exactly what happened to us. So, and we had already toured with Cyndi Lauper and NXS and Berlin and Talk, and I mean they were spending gobs of money on us. It was going to be a big, huge release, and just about a few months before that, they just pulled the plug because of politics and just people just like, you know, playing games with each other. So lesson learned. That was my first record deal that almost happened and was crushed in the most amazing way. So I learned a lot.
That's crazy.
Yeah. Well,
do you feel that like, since your band did get to open up with all these amazing artists and you had, such contacts with them, do you think that was maybe around a breakout moment where you got an opportunity to work with all these artists or,
yeah,
it come about another way?
Well, it felt that way then, but you know, those are working touring musicians. They really live and die by their attorneys and schedulers and managers. So you can meet all the artists you want, but it really doesn't. I mean, they're busy, you know. So we met people and met Michael Hutchins and met, you know, Cyndi Lauper and rapped a lot and did that kind of thing. But the minute we were off the tour, we didn't keep talking anymore. All you can really do in this business is kind of keep running into those people and you end up being friends, but everybody's so busy, you know, so no one really is friends in a way. It's just kind of giant fields of acquaintances. That's what the business sort of feels like to me.
So how did you get to the next point to where you were working with some of these artists like P. Diddy and Neptunes and stuff like that? What was your breakout moment to get there?
Well, after the Bang Bang record, the lead guy and I pretty much broke up the band and reformed under another name and made another record on Atlantic Records. And then I quit that and joined another band on Island Records. So I was really just, I could say I was being somewhat of a band whore, I guess you could say, so to speak. I was just going from record deal to record deal, having a great old time, partying like crazy, mind you, touring all the time, having a lot of fun. And then I got burnt out. I just hated it. You know, the road didn't agree with me. It's too insular. It's too bubbled out. I don't travel well. So after a few months of that, it kind of wore off and I realized. And I was mixing bands live in between tours. So that's how I didn't make much money on the road. I made it kind of home mixing bands. So I knew I didn't want to tour anymore. I knew that I really didn't want to go for the whole band thing anymore. I didn't want to keep, you know, trying to be a bass player in a band. I was just sort of over it. It was 10 years straight of some decent success, I guess. So I decided I was going to make records. I figure, well, I like working the gear. I know how to make records. I'll just make records. I can stay in LA. I can do work on cool music all the time. I can work on big records. That was the plan. So I end up joining a studio, and I already had a lot of knowledge because I already made 3 or 4 big records. I already mixed maybe 4,000 live shows. So I was really, I was really kind of dialed in. So in about a year at this studio there, I just took off, went to another studio and told them I was a chief engineer, and they hired me as a chief engineer after 1 year working at another studio. I got away with it. And bam, I was just doing it. At that point, this one studio called Devonshire Studio was just crazy. They were weird with the money. So a lot of bands were coming in, a lot of acts were coming in, and the Temptations came in one day, and they just, I mean, I was around, so I recorded them on a song, and I worked with the Glenn Miller Orchestra with like the original guys at this place. It was just crazy. So I cut my teeth at the studio and just got into it. And then in about maybe 3 years of doing that, I found myself at the record plant, and the record plant is the best. Mm. So once you end up there, you're really good at what you do. You can handle any situation, and whatever happens, you're the man there. So record plant pretty much was that demarcation. As soon as I was at the record plant, I felt like, okay, I'm making records for people now. So at that point, I was actually not a musician anymore, even though I still was, but I was fully invested into making records around the LA studio community.
So at this point in your career, because, you know, looking at your biography and things online, I was kind of under the impression that you were like, you know, primarily bass guitarist, instrumentalist, and then moved into engineering. But it seems like you were kind of doing both of these things at the same time. Did you have like a preference? Like you preferred being in the studio mixing or playing, or you just loved both equally?
Well, in and out, it oscillates. Right now, I'm not so hot on working a lot of production. Right now, I'm sort of into writing right now. So I'm not, and I can't do both.
Mm.
I can't be working on other people's records and then turning on my computer and going, all right, I can't wait to get down on my stuff. It doesn't work. You get burnt out. So you have to invest in one thing or another. So when they did happen at the same time, it was a fluke. So your impression was right. I mean, my early career was all musician, and then I ended up in the studio, and then my musicianship ended up in making records at the same time.
Right, right.
A great example would be Glenn Tipton. I was engineering on his record. So I've been working on it for some months, and it was real late at night. And he's going to catch a 6 a.m. flight, 4 in the morning. We're trying to finish up months of work doing quick rough mixes. But a few days before that, I told him I can play some bass. And I said, hey, bring your bass down. You know, bring your bass down. We'll plug you in. We'll see what we can do, and blah, blah, blah. And I was like, oh, great, you know. So I set it in the corner, and he looked at it for a couple of days, but I wasn't going to bug him. Anyway, back to him about ready to leave. So as a joke, he's packing up, getting ready to hit the airport. I go back and I stick on my bass and I walk out and I go, okay, Mr. Tipton, I'm ready to lay down my bass parts. Well, he felt terrible. He was, oh, mate, I'm sorry. I was going to get to you, you know, oh, geez, I got to go. And I was like, man, I am just so messing with you. Don't worry about it. He's holding his leg. Okay. So 6 months later, I get a call from his assistant and said, Glenn said to pick any basses or gear out. He's coming in on this date. We booked a room at Devonshire Studio, and you're going to record some bass for Glenn. I was like, holy crap. Really? He was just making good on something I said. I mean, he's such a gentleman, you know. He's really an upstanding cat, you know. So I get the call, and I'm like, okay, great, you know. So I order, you know, the basses I think I would like to try, and the cabinets and all this stuff. And then Glenn flies into town with his buddy, another producer named Mark Dodson. Mark worked on some records I worked on with him, and he was the engineer on this record, so I was kind of co-engineering with Mark Dodson. So they came in a week before, and they said, hey, you know, so we went, that's what we were going to dinners afterwards for about a week before the session. We were going out because I was helping on the record engineering, and we were working on other stuff with Glenn. And then they were needling me every night, like, hey, you know, you're going to play on Glenn's thing. You're going to be okay. You're nervous. You know, they're like needling me. And I was, and in front of people, in front of like Lemmy, you know, we're in front of Lemmy. They were trying to give me a hard time in front of Lemmy about me playing in a record and me being nervous. And I had mentioned to Lemmy, I said, "Do you realize I'm playing on Glenn Tipton's record and he's never heard me play before?" So Glenn was sort of embarrassed that was true. You know, Glenn never heard me play. So why am I playing on Glenn's record? I was almost confused. So I was giving them crap back, you know. And so anyway, they gave me this one song, and it was a speed metal. It was fast, very intricate, very fast, speed metal, all of very difficult stuff, okay? And he already had Billy Sheehan on his record and Robert Trujillo, right? So he had two of the greatest bass players in the world on his record. And here I am getting ready to play on a song. And I'm like, you know, they were giving me all kinds of help. And anyway, luckily I had a tape. I practiced 5 nights later. And after all this hell they've been giving me, we finally get to the studio. And finally, I'm the artist. I'm sitting in there in the chair, you know, and they're getting a sound for me. And I'm playing the bass like an idiot for them. You know, I'm getting a, like on purpose. I'm messing with them. I'm like going doink, doink, doink. I'm practicing poorly, you know?
Yeah.
So they think
just to scare him a little bit.
Yeah, you know, or let them think it's a wash. We're just doing this because we love CJ. He wants to play on the record. Okay, all right. We love him. We were friends like that. They were pulling off a session for me just to be nice. Blah, blah, blah. So I'm like, you ready? I'm like, ready, you know? And they said, do you want a rundown? I said, no, drop me in. You know, just go ahead and record me. And I said, okay. They dropped me in and bam, I hit that bass like a champ. Went through the whole 5 minute long song. I hit every note. That's solid. Awesome. Bam! End the song. And they sat there with their jaws on the floor. Then they were jumping up and down like crazy. They couldn't believe what they were hearing. So I did a few more drop-ins, repeated a few things, and then we went out to dinner and they celebrated and then they booked more time and then more time and more time. And I ended up playing on 5 songs. So I'm on record with Trujillo, Sheehan, and me playing bass and some Cozy Powell on drums. This is some really old. This is some old stuff. But that was one of my favorite you know, music stories where I ended up in the studio.
That's awesome. I love that.
Phenomenal. You know,
well, then Glenn called me up a few months later because he's finishing up the record. He's putting it together, uh-huh. And he called. He goes, "How would you like to be credited?" And I said, "Well, I engineered a bunch of songs and I played bass on a song, so I'd like credit for those." And he says, "Well, we can't be having your fucking name all over my fucking record, can we?" He was all pissed off that my name was going to be all over it, you know? And more than anybody's. So there, I was up against the problem, to kind of answer your question. I was up against the issue of being a bass player and being an engineer on a record at the same time, because that's an issue. So I told Glenn, I said, "Put me down as bass player." He goes, "Oh, that's a good choice." So.
Michael Jackson. His new album, Invincible. Order Michael Jackson's Invincible now and get a free poster. Order Michael Jackson's Invincible. Call now.
Hey, this is really, really Brad Sundberg, studio engineer and technical director for Michael Jackson and host of In the Studio with MJ. You're listening to the MJCast.
I engineered a bunch of stuff, but so I took the bass credits. And the same thing sort of happened with MJ. Actually, almost exactly the same happened with MJ on A Place With No Name. I mentioned I can play. I brought my bass down. It was kind of a fluke, you know? And just Michael loved what I was playing. So
you have to share that story then.
That was a lot of fun. I mean, working with Michael alone, sure, what a thrill that was. And, you know, the energy of the man is it's true. It's just the musical aura of this guy is huge. And of course, I grew up with Michael, so I had a different, maybe a more powerful reception to that. But I was also in, you know, production for many, many years, so I wasn't starstruck anymore. So I can't say that I was starstruck with Michael. I just felt that he really was a real musical power, you know. So when I was working with him, I'd only been working with him for a couple months.
How did you come to first work with him? Sorry.
Well, that was an interesting story. That I was at the record plant, and I was one of the top. I was one of the chief engineers there, so they always put me on the tweaky sessions, on the ones that were difficult or people were hard to work with or things like that. So Rose Mancherny, Rose was booking the record plant. She was running, booking, and part owner of the record plant. And she put me on a session with Michael, where Michael was going to test out engineers. He was looking for an engineer. He was looking for somebody to work with. And so I was, Rose put me on the session as a second engineer. So basically I come with the room. I make sure you have a smooth session no matter what. So this was the second or third time I worked with Michael as a second engineer. I had worked with him a few years before that with Eddie Delana. But so Michael explained to me, he says, we're going to check out some of these guys. I'm paraphrasing. I can't remember exactly what he said, but basically we're going to check out some of these guys. We're going to go through the motions and we're just going to, you know, I'm going to, you know, check out these engineers. I said, great, whatever I can do. So he kind of had a schedule. These guys kind of coming in, he was going to meet them. He was going to work with them for a second. He was going to let them go. And that's what we did. So the first guy came in. It's good that I can't remember their names because they would be embarrassed with the stories. But these were guys who had Grammys and things like that. And so the first cat came in. Michael sat it down at the chair, and Michael just was throwing, you know, kind of questions and production things at the guy. He was trying to figure out the level of sophistication of technology, because Michael really wants someone to perform in the room. And so he asked him to do something very unusual. Now, Michael, one of the main thing Michael does is to comp vocal tracks. So Michael will sing a bunch of tracks and will construct a vocal take out of many takes. And so he asked this engineer to do it in a very unusual way on the SSL console. He said, I want to comp a vocal on the console. And that was very unusual. That I knew that right away, that Michael was throwing this guy a curveball. You know, he gave him, you know, he was just testing him. So here's a test, dude, you know, sink or swim. And so the dude was already sort of like going, oh, damn. You know, I can see him going, oh, okay. So he was sort of poking at it. And then, you know, 10 seconds later, you know, nothing was happening. So the guy was sort of stuck. Well, just by the mere nature of why I was there working as a second engineer, I stepped over the guy's shoulders and I hit the correct buttons and got him going, you know. And then he sort of got moving again with Michael, and they were practicing some button switches for the comp. And then the guy got stuck again. I leaned over and hit the correct buttons, you know. So I was sort of keeping the session going, even though Michael was sort of testing this guy. I couldn't help it. It's kind of what we do, you know? Mm. So that the guy got out of his chair and said, you do it.
I feel sorry for this guy, but what a great opportunity for you.
Well, yeah, and the guy did the right thing because, you know, he knows that there's somewhat of a code, I guess you can call it a code, but, you know, no matter what happens, the session doesn't stop. Michael is the point. So when two engineers are in a room, whoever can do it is going to do it. Yeah. So he naturally got up out of the chair and said, you do it. And that would naturally happen because we're trying to get a session going for Michael Jackson. And that was sort of what was, and so the guy was correct in his, it was the astute thing to do, but it wasn't what Michael wanted, obviously. So, you know, they worked a little more and they had a nice conversation, and Michael is always very gracious and very sweet man. And he sent him on his way. And that was the day for that. That took a few hours to get through. And I thought that was very interesting for me as an engineer in the room. So Michael and I parted ways for that day. We came back the next day and there was a new guy. And this happened three times, but the other one was kind of like this one. This is kind of a similar story. So another guy came in, had the exact same chat, but this time Michael threw a different technological issue on him, but this was easier. And this was comping on this Sony recorder. It's called a 3348 and has all these buttons, a million buttons on it. And of course I was very fluid on it. So the guy was sitting down and he kind of should have been fluid on it, I thought. And he was kind of, you know, same thing, kind of not, you know, Michael's very, you know, you can tell that it's, things got to be snappy. I mean, Michael is not, you know, you got to go fast. As fast as Michael is the whole idea. So the second engineer was trying to get through it, and I kept leaning over, hitting the right buttons. And that guy, of course, being the astute engineer that he was, did the exact same thing, got out of his chair and said, "You do it." So I got out of the chair and I started comping with Michael. And so Michael was looking at me like, "Dude," you know, and I was like, "Oh, well, you know." So the same thing, he finishes conversation with that man. And 3 or 4 days later, after one more guy, we only tested three guys, it's kind of the same deal. Michael looked at me and said, "Why don't you be my engineer?" And I said, "Yeah, you know, I'm ready. Let's do this. Let's work, Michael. I want to get to it." And he's going, "Great," you know. And that was it. The next day, some assistant from some attorney plopped a 30-page contract in front of me, and I signed it, and that was it. And the next day, I was working in the studio with MJ.
Wow.
Now, at this point, were you guys still working as far as studio stuff? Were you guys working on digitally yet, or was it still tape?
It was digital tape, so it was both.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was the Sony 3348. That was Michael's favorite machine. And believe it or not, it was 48 tracks on half inch, but it was a gorgeous sounding machine. They probably weigh about 800 pounds. Back in the day, they cost, $150,000.
Yeah, those things are pretty massive.
Yeah, you can't give them away now. You can't give them away. They're just throwing them in the ocean now at this point. So, so yeah, that was Michael's preferred format. We were doing a little bit of pro tooling, but back then we were, let's say, transferring. We were taking stuff off the Sony machine, putting it into Pro Tools, doing our edits, and going back to the Sony machine. And that was kind of Michael's MO back then. He wasn't sold on staying in Pro Tools totally yet.
Oh, okay.
So I've just got to ask too, just for a bit of context for my own head. So you said you worked on some Michael Jackson material prior to this with Eddie Delano. Now,
yes.
Would that have been during sort of the mid to late 90s?
Yes, exactly right. That would have been 94-ish.
Yeah, so that would have been for the History album probably.
Probably, you know, that was at Royal Tone Studios to be exact. And, you know, Michael kind of constantly works and then those songs turn into records. So I would say it was definitely that grouping of songs.
Okay. You worked on those songs with him and then later sort of came back for Place With No Name?
Place With No Name was, that was fall of 98 was when I played bass on that. And I had recorded, you got me in a corner of my mind I haven't been in for a while. You probably know better than I do. I don't have an encyclopedic knowledge. I just kind of go by my experiences concerning Michael.
That's fine. I'm just trying to get my head around like what exact songs. So it was like a history, rough history era songs. And then it was A Place With No Name, Blue Gangster.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And that was 98, 99.
Got it.
The story for the bass playing. So I was working with Dr. Freeze, who's a real awesome cat, man. He did A Place With No Name and he did some of the early boys. He did Poison, you know, those early New Jack Swing hits back in the day. So he was working on, he was Michael's producer, one of Michael's producers. And we were, we were dropping in some rough vocals. Michael was still kind of writing lyrics with Freeze. And we were dropping in some quick, rough mixed lyric stuff. And I had mentioned to Michael and Freeze that, they said, oh, maybe some real bass. Like they meant live bass, because Michael is usually on a synth bass guitar. I mean, it's synth bass. It's usually that stuff, right? So they mentioned that, oh, maybe I want, you know, live bass on this. And Freeze thought that was a good idea. Well, the minute I heard that, of course, I was like, okay. Well, I play bass, you know, and this is my Glenn Tipton moment again. I was like, all right, let's try to do this again. I said, well, listen, I've played for years. I can drop in and see if you guys like it at least. Maybe you hear something. And they're like, yeah, well, like I said, I can bring my bass down, you know, all that stuff I like to say. And they said, yeah, bring it down, you know. So Same thing. I bring it down and I take it out of the case and I sit it in the corner so they can see it. Because I'm not going to mention it again. You know what I mean? I don't want to be forward and rude. I don't want to be discovered. I don't want to be forceful, you know? Mm-hmm. So Freeze, you know, says, hey man, this might be a good time, you know, to drop in and try out some ideas. Well, it was a bit early, you know, and I knew Michael was still in the lounge. And because Michael didn't know me as a bass player, even though I mentioned it to him. I didn't want him with me while I did it. You know, that would be a major distraction to have Michael Jackson in your face.
It's very true.
while you're trying to work out, what am I going to play? You know, you want to go there in your mind, you know? And so I told Freeze, I want to wait till he goes. And he said, yeah, okay. So a few hours later, it was later in the evening. Michael's always gone by then. But, you know, we don't check up on him. Like, you know, have you gone yet, Michael? You know, we're not going to do that. So I just figured he'd left because he'd never been there that late for a while, at least. So I strap on my bass. I plug in. You know, I get myself a sound. I'm, you know, going through modules and things. And I find a sound. I'm like, this is pretty heavy. I kind of like this. And then I hit play on the recorder. Freeze is right there. I hit play. I just got an input. I'm just sort of jamming around trying to get some sounds. I'm sort of feeling around. I think I have something I want to do. And then I see Michael walk out the door of his lounge. Now, there's nothing but glass in all these booths. So Michael has to go through two rooms of glass before he comes in our third room. So I'm like, so it was a long... It was a long walk from Michael leaving that room, walking into the studio, because I'm like going, oh, damn.
He's here.
Oh, I'm not even going to get a chance to play. This is it. I'm going to have to put the bass down. He's going to want to do something else. You know, my moment, you know, that's fine. I was resigning it to like going, oh, well, that was pretty good. I gave it a good shot, you know. So he walks in. I stopped tape immediately, like I got caught. And... He's going, what are you guys doing? And I'm like, I'm just laying down some bass. And he's like, can I hear it? And I'm like, yeah, okay. You know, so I didn't record anything. So I go to the top. I hit play. I'm on input again. So I'm playing along, playing the idea. And he's going, yeah, okay. And so I'm coming up with this lick at the same time. I'm still searching for notes. And, you know, it was a very simple thing. And simple is hard. If anybody here is a musician, you know, being original and simple are the two hardest things you can put together.
Yeah, very true.
Right? And so Michael is in my face while I'm trying to do this. And he's going, are you recording any of these ideas? I said, no. And he's like, oh, my God, what are you doing? He's like getting mad at me. You know, and I'm like, okay. You know, so but he was excited, you know, he wasn't mad. He was just like, let's do this. I'm liking it, you know? So I hit record and I just take off like I'm a rock star, you know? So I'm playing and he is grooving with me. He's playing air guitar. He's biting the lip. He's getting in the face. He's clapping. He's throwing up his arms. He's jumping up and down with me. And it was really kind of throwing me at first, but I realized that he's trying to get me going. You know, this was after the session. I realized that he was all about inspiration and he just wanted to inspire me. So I guess he did, you know, because I ended up coming up with the part kind of during that. And so I stopped tape at the end of the song. And he's going, oh, I love that. That's so stinky, CJ. It's so stinky. You know, stinky for him was like, you know, awesome. I love it.
Yeah.
And he goes, let's do it again. So I go to a new track. I drop in. I'm playing. I'm trying some different ideas. And I'm all over the place, though. I'm having fun because I'm playing slides. And I'm in his face, too, right? We're both – it was kind of like being on stage with Michael. That's what we were doing on the studio floor. It'd be like if you saw a show with him and he's got the guitarist and he's in the guitarist phase. And we're like, yeah, you know, so it was that kind of a thing. And so I dropped in three or four more times and I laid down another one that was really solid because I knew as a musician, like, oh, wait, it's not all there. You know, there's sections I didn't play. And if they try to put this together, you know, it won't all be there. So I played a really solid track so they can at least assemble something. And then that was the one I used for a quick mix. So after I was done, Michael was ecstatic. I was going, what the hell's going on at that point? Because I was like, oh my gosh, he's loving what I mean, in 30 minutes, I did all this, you know? And so I did a quick mix, and he thanked me again, and he left the studio. And that was the last I heard of it. That was it. I was like, well, that was fun. You know, there's no way I'm ending up on this record, you know, but that was fun. That's what I thought, you know? And then that was it until 2000. And when did the TMZ leaked 30 seconds of that song, right?
Yeah, that's correct. That happened just after he passed away, I'm pretty sure.
That's right. And then a friend of mine played me that. And I said, oh my gosh, that's the song. And I said, oh my gosh, that's me playing bass. So I'm like, what is going on? This is 10 years later. So I was really excited to hear that. You know, wow, you know, I'm on a little 30-second clip with Michael Jackson. I took that as like, I'll take that. Oh, that's cool. Yeah. You know, I got that. I got a story. I got a clip. Everybody got a – because I was telling the story, but, you know, I had nothing to – I had no proof.
Yeah.
Yeah, nothing to back it up. Everybody's like, yeah, sure, you played with Michael Jackson.
Right? So, you know, I didn't get a whole lot of that, but you get that in everybody's mind, you know, or it wasn't solid enough. So then I heard he was making a record. I heard there was a record coming out, and I realized that, wow, what if they put this song on there? How do I get a credit? I had no idea how to get a credit. I tried to call the camp. Everybody was different. I tried to get to the managers and the estate people. No one can get me a call there. I called an attorney friend of mine. I said, listen, I'll pay you. Just badger these people. Let them know I played bass on this song, you know?
Yeah.
And he said, there's nothing I can do. They're just like, you know, it's locked up right now. I said, it's crazy, because I was calling at the exact time they were working all this stuff out, which is really, that's when the door sort of closed, you know? Because it's just, people are jockeying for positions. It's highly politicized getting a credit on an MJ record. And I was sort of, I worked on Break of Dawn, and I didn't get credited on that.
Wow. That's one of my favorite all-time MJ tracks. It is beautiful.
I didn't get a credit on that. It was just, I had no power. I had nothing. I didn't have representation. I didn't have an attorney. I was kind of a loose punk rock engineer at the time. I didn't have my shit totally together, fellas. You know, I was like, you know, I was swimming with these big stars, but I was playing, I was on my own. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Anyway, at that point, I think it was a couple of years before that, I wanted to tell my story right after the TMZ clip came out. So I wrote a post. I wanted to tell my story. I wanted to tell it in a way, because I was getting a lot of emails to, you know, about it and what was going on. So I wrote out that story as best as I could. I'm not really a storyteller, but I wrote it myself. It's a little, it reads okay still, but I wish I can change it.
Not a storyteller. I'm pretty sure you're doing a good job on this show, man.
Really? Yeah. Right. Yeah, we're loving the story. So.
This is amazing.
Okay. All right. Fair enough. And then, to make that long story short, you know, the record came out and there I was.
Excellent.
And I was thrilled. And the engineering stuff's good. I got engineering credits on a couple songs. That's great. But the bass one is the one.
Yeah.
Because it was with Michael. We did it together. You know, it was inspired. I mean, literally, I don't know what to think of it other than I come up with these little factoids, I think, in my mind. Like, that has to be the quickest bass session on any Michael Jackson record ever.
Very true.
I mean, this guy takes 5 years to make a record, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And that was literally, it went down in five recording passes. That went down in 30 minutes, you know? And then he worked on it for 10 years. You know, I was reading some of Freeze's stories, and they were going to studios with it. And when I read the stories after the fact, I was like, oh my gosh, you know, Michael had all the chance in the world and all the means in the world to put somebody else on there, to change the bass, to get the greatest, you know, to get whoever on there, and he never did. And so I get a big thrill out of that. So the bass credit is the one. It's the creative credit. It was a creative process with Michael Jackson is what I cherish the most about the whole thing.
It's one of my favorite tracks. I had that little leak. Like, I put that on my iPhone to listen to just over because I loved that. Like, yeah. You know, it was always a classic track when it was the America track. So it was already such a great, great melody and hook. But when that leak came out, I was like, oh, my God, this is amazing. And I'd always prayed to hear the whole thing. And then when we got to hear the original, oh, my God, it's such a good track. It's just
beautiful. I loved it, too. Yes. Yeah. Michael loved that song. I mean, who didn't love that song, especially if you grew up during that time? It's still a huge classic. You know, Michael is a real artist. He wants to work on things just because he wants to, you know. I don't think Michael sort of much makes plans with music. I think he sort of just muses and goes forward and just lurches and has fun with music. And we get the benefit of doing what he wants to do. So I think he just loved that song so much, and so did Freeze. And, you know, the hip-hop culture, it's very natural to flip anything. Just flip any song you want. And so, you know, that was Michael and Freeze just putting love into it, you know. I don't think they went after that track like it was supposed to be put on a record. I think it was even more personal than that. Although I think Freeze tells it a little different, that they went after it in a way. But I would go with what he says over what I say. But, you know, the feeling I got during the time is that they were just having so much fun trying to play with this melody and the lyrics and the music and really having a good time flipping this classic track. And, you know, a successful flip isn't easy. And I thought that was just wonderful. You know, I thought it was great when I heard it too.
Well, America liked it as well.
Yes, that's right.
They had great things to say about the new version.
Yeah. And I suppose it helped me loving that song when I was playing the bass, I suppose. Because before I played on Michael's version, I had heard that song 10,000 times since I was a kid. So I got to wonder if that wasn't in my, you know, spirit, so to speak, while I was playing, while Michael was in my face trying to inspire me too. You know, I almost channeled that bass part, I think, through all those things at that moment. So, you know, studio magic, you know, I'm a firm believer in it. You know, it seems kind of a little magical thing to stay, but that's what those people are all about. Those people, huge stars or huge music makers, you know, they understand how to get inspiration down to disc or whatever you want to call it. And that's what matters. And Michael, I think, may have been the greatest at that. Another thing I noticed about him was that musical energy was relentless. I don't know. He was like a child in a discovery sense. Like, usually a guy around his age is somewhat jaded, kind of over it. The studio's old. You're like, oh, come on. You know, your ears are a little like, you know, you're a snob. I mean, you can't help it as you get older, especially, you know, Michael and I were in our, you know, he was in his 40s at that point, just in his 40s. But he still had that wide-eyed, like, searching for it, searching for magic thing. And it was very obvious. And every time I worked with him, he was reaching for that. And so few people do.
But yeah, I wanted to bring it back because I did want to say about the remix album that they did, the Escape or whatever. The new version of A Place With No Name.
Yeah.
I do have to agree with you. They just didn't hit the mark on that one. It's like, I just feel like, and I don't know if you, since you haven't really had a chance to listen to the, you said you heard the remix album, but I think what happened was that they never showed them the original song that you did whenever the new producers made the new song. So they had no clue, that it was a remake of that song. And and so they totally went a different direction with it. And then they showed them the song after they'd already made the remix. And they're like, oh, it's supposed to be that.
Are you kidding? That is crazy.
Yeah. So I think that they actually probably would have went the direction that you guys were going, like they were supposed to, if they would have heard the song beforehand.
I wish they would have, like a thing they could have done with that particular mix, that it would have been okay, other than they took all the backgrounds out of the hook.
Yeah.
You know, they just made it just kind of solo Michael singing the hook. And when you hear the original hook, it's got the huge, ridiculous Michael pad that we've all grown up with. That's kind of about right. And if they would have had the huge Michael, let the bigness come in of his vocals, it would have been, I'm getting a little production technical here, but I felt going to the solo voice was like a little too stripped down, you know, and
yeah,
I don't know. I sort of missed the mark on some other areas. And, you know, also, you know, if you're going to go with that big 808, it doesn't translate on a lot of systems that people would normally listen to a Michael Jackson song.
Very true.
Kind of, right. It's kind of a thumper that really won't translate over smaller systems. So it sounds a little empty, you know, on systems that don't bump, you know. So I don't know. It was okay. I kind of like the fact that everybody likes the version I played on best. So
Hell yeah.
I can play that a little bit. I'm not exactly mad. You know.
Yeah, and lucky for us, that version is still available for us to go listen to.
Thank God. Exactly.
As I drove across on the highway, my Jeep began to rock. I didn't know what to do, so I stopped and got out and looked down. I noticed I got a flat. So I walked out, parked the car like sideways. Cars on
Hi, this is Michael Prince, studio engineer and producer with Michael Jackson, and you're listening to the MJ Cast.
Another song that you worked on was Blue Gangsta. Do you have any stories about that process with that song?
No, that was pretty straightforward. I recorded mainly the instruments on that and some of Michael's scratch vocals, which were amazing. I thought Michael's detail with the vocals was really gorgeous with that. When I heard the finished vocal, I heard Michael Jackson at 40 something being great. Mm. You know what I'm saying? That's super mature, like Jordan, you know, he doesn't need to be fast anymore, but he can still beat you because he knows where to go because he's 40. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So Michael kind of had that super experience sound, even though the youthfulness may have been off the edge a little bit, there was a different kind of experience in his magic. So I heard it on Blue Gangsta. So I really enjoyed hearing that. I think Mike Ging did most of the vocals on that. And I did all the instruments on that and some of Michael's scratch vocals. Yeah.
And that song continued to be worked on for a long time, I think, after you worked on it. Just adding little bits of percussion and stuff here and there. I think Michael was working a lot with Brad Buxer and Michael Prince.
Yes.
Did you have much involvement with those two guys as well?
Not with Michael Prince. We passed in the halls occasionally. We, you know, he knew who I was. I know who he is. And, Michael had several engineers going at once. So, you know, there was a few engineers caving in a studio somewhere, and we would see each other at a distance. So that's how I knew Michael. And maybe a quick chat at a party, and that was about it. But Brad, I worked with quite a bit beforehand.
Yeah.
So I knew Brad very well. And we were in the same circles. We had some of the same friends.
I always felt that Blue Gangsta, I'm sure you're familiar with Timbaland. That's correct. The hip hop producer. I always felt like later on down the line, Blue Gangsta kind of had that Timbaland feel to it. Like it was supposed to be made by Timbaland or something.
Well, I got to say, man, what he did to that was amazing. I can't believe it. I mean, the remix version of it is stunning. So I guess it played into his hand a little bit. I loved what he did with it. A lot of people get mad at the remixes. I'm not mad at the remixes at all. The only one I'm mad at, I shouldn't say mad at, but the one I thought they missed a little bit was the A Place With No Name one. I thought that was a bit of a miss for me. But that's a very young sounding track too, and I'm an older guy, so maybe that's an issue.
No, but the original's way better, gotta say.
For sure.
You know, of course, I'm completely 100% biased on it, but the other tracks, stellar. I mean, oh my God, really great. Michael would have loved them. Michael would have loved them.
The orchestral introduction to Blue Gangsta is really magical.
Wonderful. Yeah. I mean, you know, on Blue Gangsta, you know, Jerry Hay, he did the horns on it and he did a wonderful job, and Timbaland kind of mixed them out. And he had to, you know, he had to. So, you know, poor Jerry Hay, you know, those horns on that, on the original are just absolutely ridiculous. I love horns. But Timbaland's remix is redonkulous. So I thought it was great. And the vocals sounded great too. Wonderful.
I want to ask a little bit about a song that you worked on that's quite mysterious still in the Michael Jackson fan world, and the song is Monster.
Yes.
There's still a lot of sort of misinformation out there about it and that kind of thing. I'd love for you to take us through the journey of Monster and what you did on it and Michael's vision for it.
When I got to it, it was pretty involved. It was already over 100 tracks, and I was at record one. And we recorded vocals on it. So I made a work reel. So basically, we were in the room that had, I don't know, it had like 102 input SSL. And we needed that, actually. Mm. I had two Sony machines that were full. So that was 96 tracks.
Ooh.
And so the orchestra, there was an orchestra laid out, huge amount of percussion, There was flies buzzing. There was, it was very experimental. I mean, it sounded like a very personal Michael Jackson song to me. Very personal. And I would say, and I use this analogy often, but it's not exactly inaccurate, but it's very much, I kind of took it like kind of one of his Sgt. Pepper songs, you know, that he went kind of art instead of trying to hitting us over the pop noggin, you know, like he's great at doing, you know, he reached down into some, in kind of a different place for this song. More challenging to listen to would be the best way to put it. So it was very interesting. So I had to take all those tracks. I did a mix. He was coming into the studio occasionally, but then I had a long 2-day period where I didn't see him. I was at record one. So I mixed up for as long as I could and then made a work reel, which means I took those 96 tracks and I got a third Sony machine, locked all three up, and I put 8 tracks down to the work track. So I had 2 tracks of drums on it, 2 tracks of effects, 2 tracks of keyboards, 2 tracks of percussion. And then that released 40 channels
of tape. Yeah.
Okay. So then that was our vocal reel. So after I had made that, Michael would come into the studio and would sing on Monster. Now, I guess Monster is the name of it.
Yeah.
The hook I recorded, he sang, "You created a monster."
That's right. Yeah. The hook
that he sang.
Yeah.
So maybe that's the title, but maybe it's just Monster.
Can I just ask that on that note, like I've heard this song before. I don't know what sort of state of completion I've heard it in, but the accounts are right. It sounds instrumentally, probably in my opinion, the most complex Michael instrumental I've ever heard. There is so much going on. It's incredible.
Agreed.
But the vocal I've heard, the version I've heard, there is only the hook you described in the chorus. There's no other vocal. Did you record any other Michael vocal for that song?
Wow. Oh, that's a good question.
Oh. I'm probably taking you back here.
Wow. You're just like, oh, my mind. I'm going to pass out. Hang on a second.
Sorry, we like to get into detail here on the show. So.
Well, no, this is a lot of fun. Now I definitely recall the hook because we did a huge stack. We did a lot of stacks. Then we did, okay. I remember filling a lot of stuff. Now we did a lot of experimental vocals. He may have sung some verses. I don't know if they were experimental to him.
Yeah.
I don't know. Let me put it this way. When I recall almost filling that reel, 40 tracks, okay?
Yeah.
Now, was it with verses and a bridge? I don't know. Maybe had some skeletal ideas of that.
Yeah.
But I know we practically filled it. I mean, I actually had a problem. He's so fast that he remembers where he is in tracks and stuff, and he wants to go back and he wants to record an idea, and then he wants to go to this section of tape and record an idea, and then he wants to go here. Now, we're on tape. So this is when I made the money. I was paid right, you know, because what made that difficult is that we weren't in Pro Tools, so you can't see the audio about to come up.
Yeah.
You don't get to see audio. It's only tape and needles bouncing. So he would ask me, oh, there's a section of tape here, I want to record something. Well, right after that is the bridge. So I have to be careful to take it out of record when he sings on a section that has something after it. So the vocal session was, after about a week, was getting complicated. There was parts flying around all over this reel, including the hook that you mentioned. And I remember he was singing something and I can see a note I wrote because I was furiously writing notes because I couldn't keep up with Michael. It's like, you know, I also had to keep him from making a mistake, right? Part of my job too was to help him not screw up, you know? So he was singing and we were coming up to a part that I was about to record over. So I was like, I was at a catch 22. I had to drop out. So I had to drop out in the middle of a vocal. And so I dropped out. He goes, "What are you doing?" And I'm like, "Oh my God, Michael Jackson's yelling at me, first of all." I'm going, Michael, it's the beatbox was right on that. It was right after. He goes, "Oh, thanks for dropping me out." And I was like, "Oh my gosh." I was like, you know, I was like, dude, you know? And so by that story alone, that meant we were cramming the tape, you know? So I'd have to say there was a lot of stuff. In the rough mix you heard, I mean, maybe the vocal session I had with him, it's hard to say. I did that in 99.
Yeah. Did Michael ever talk to you about the song, like Monster and his vision for it and where he wanted it to go?
No. No, he did. He liked my mix a lot. He liked it so much that he made me put it to a half inch analog machine, which I thought was kind of funny. He just loved it in his headphones so much. I had 2 days to work on it, so I wanted to give him a mix in his headphones to sing against that he would enjoy. So I really made something that'd be fun to sing against, and evidently he responded to it. So he liked it enough to print it. So maybe that's what people are hearing, you know, and I may have done it with just the hook in it. I don't know. Cause I did some rough mix versions for him so we could take it home and maybe sing in the car or whatever. So Michael probably had 30 versions of it.
Wow.
As someone that, you know, just does enjoy sitting and listening to records and music, like mm-hmm. you said earlier, sort of out of Michael's catalog of work, have you got some real standouts that, yeah, you might not have worked on, but they really stand out that are favorites for you?
Oh, right. Okay. Right now, Dancing Machine still kills me.
Oh, absolutely.
Definitely.
I don't get it. I got to go to YouTube and watch the robot middle eight. I got to do it. I guess Blue Gangsta, both versions. I like, I sort of have, I kind of have a random playlist that I go through sometimes that I have some of the things I worked on that I like. But ABC, you know, the early Motown sessions just I still destroy me. I'm a nostalgic listener, you know. I'm kind of a lo-fi engineer. Like I can make a record like you wouldn't believe. But if I don't have to, I like making lo-fi records.
Mm.
Okay.
So, yeah, I mean, I like getting energy. I like hearing early sounds. I listen to old jazz. I like grimy recordings, you know?
Mm.
They're hard to do. That's why I like, they're hard to do in an artful way. I mean, you didn't have to try back in the day. They were automatic. They sounded old because it was forever ago.
Yeah.
But I like putting a lot of character into records, so I don't listen technically anymore. I listen purely nostalgically. Like if an old Michael Jackson song comes on, I'm bouncing around. I'm not like drilling down with my ears trying to hear the trying to hear James Jamerson, trying to get those. No, I'm not doing that. I'm bouncing in my seat singing the lyrics. You know, so even though I'm an engineer producer, I like going there. You know what I'm saying?
I like some of that. Yeah. I like some of that stuff from the late 70s, early 80s, that really organic slap bass kind of sound. The stuff Lewis Johnson was doing on Off the Wall and Thriller.
Thank you. Yes, yes, yes. Yeah, because it was really hard to manipulate tape back in the day. So you hear it was just more real because it was very played. You know, those records had musicians, the drummers played those disco beats.
Mm.
You know, click tracks weren't exactly popular back then. And then, you know, we can only edit a little bit by cutting up tape. You know, we cut tape a little bit back in the day between drum takes and things like that. But generally, those records that you like, I like them for the same reasons. You plug in, you played, and that was the deal. So we like how they're unadulterated.
Mm.
They're not pro tooled. They're not tuned. They're not timed out. They're not, you know, you had to drop in, you know, you had to craft those records before you mixed them. Now you make them when you mix.
Yeah, so, I do feel that a lot of music nowadays does lose a lot of that feeling because of the accessibility of it all.
Oh my gosh. It's Luckily, I've taught my nephews. They're musicians. They are complete players. I didn't even show them how to edit. Now they know how to edit anyway. They'll edit 10 milliseconds. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, stop with the editing all the time. Just play. Which works, as they can play now, but now they also know how to edit. But I agree with you. You know, the records now, people tend to tuck in the corners too much and cut the little phrase off.
Exactly.
And, you know, you got to leave that stuff in there because people hear that. They want to, like, I want to hear the singer inhale.
Yeah. Flaws of an album make it feel real. You know, it doesn't feel like a digital composition. Composition. That's the word.
It feels like a recorded event. I want to hear an event, not a constructed event. So
that's why a lot of fans love that stuff from so there's a couple of really great demo tracks that Michael did with his siblings, his brothers and sisters, in their Havenhurst studio. I think it was Working Day and Night and Don't Stop Till You Get Enough demos, where you can hear them like banging around on glasses of water and just it's just so organic.
I live for that. That's where it's at for making records, all records. Any record, any artist, you know, so, and that's how I, you know, those are the artists I wanted to work with. Those are the people, those are the friends I kind of have, that kind of energy. My engineer friends are that way too. I don't have the super duper technical engineer producer friends. I don't want to make records like that. Michael does. I always did. Michael takes too long, you know, and you know, but Michael can, you know, and I don't mean to digress, but when I was working with Quincy Jones, I asked him. I actually had a lot of guts back then. I should have been fired from a few sessions. But I asked Quincy to his face, "How come you don't work with Michael anymore?" And he says, "Because I like to finish." I thought that was brilliant, you know. I mean, and Quincy was a bit incredulous. He was like, "Oh my gosh!" "Michael takes forever to make records." Like, I heard that come out of him. But Quincy takes a second to make a record. Quincy is writing it, composing it, handing out the music, people recording it, and he's mixing it, and he's on to the next thing. So, and that's Quincy's thing because he's so prolific that he's just darting forward. Michael wants to let his spirit just dwell on it until he can't anymore. That's really how he makes records. So he will take forever. So on that note, you know, Michael was definitely left to his own accord. Michael was a super duper editor, tweaky recording guy. No doubt about it.
You think that was his perfectionism that sort of slowed it down and maybe got in the way? Like, is that what your experience sort of was?
Well, he only got in the way of time and money. You know, he didn't get in the way of his own records. I don't think he ever did that. I think he got in the way of his managers and his label wanting to save money. You know, and Michael didn't think money. I don't think he ever thought about, like, figures. I think his whole life, I'm guessing, don't go to me on this, but just judging by the way he worked and how he is and other people I know that are kind of have that kind of money and that kind of power, is that he didn't have figures and dollar signs and when things cost, how he just did them until he felt they were right. It bugged other people because it cost them money, or they had to figure out how to get the money, you know, because, you know, Michael didn't want to pay for his own records. That was for the label to do or the management to do. So they were watching his budget. He never watched his own. He never did. There's no way he ever watched his own money. And it wasn't because didn't have any reverence for it. It was just because he wanted to do what he wanted to do. So the record was done when it was just done. You know, he finished when I think he was sort of forced into it more than anything, because probably contractually he was going to lose something big. And that's when he finished. I bet you, because he probably would have taken longer if he could have. Mm. But contractually, he may have been up against some you know, some pretty serious penalties if he didn't hit a few dates, you know, at the right time. Because obviously there was coordination between records getting done, tours, and advertising. So there's huge liabilities and things like that involved. So I think, you know, when you get investors involved and things like that, it gets weird. But I don't think it got weird for him.
Yeah.
He just did, you know, and he just made the records. And I think if Michael bought anything with his money on the records, he bought magic and time. He bought inspiration, you know. He was waiting for that, trying to get with that. And when he got enough of that, his record was finished. And that's what makes him magical. And that's also what makes him, he's such a brute in the studio. You know, he is strong, you know. I mean, he's got a lot of power musically. So, and he uses it. And, you know, costs money.
So did he ever have any expert advice that he gave you, or do you have anything that you might have learned from him?
He was never direct like that. We talked about like I was interested in anthropology and science and things like that. So I would read the paper or things like that. I would chat with him about things that I was interested in that maybe. Because sometimes he was really just sort of quiet, you know, a lot of the time. But little things that happened would be like, he would mess with me a little bit, you know. When we were working on Monster, at that point, he was driving himself down to the studio with Prince, with his boy, his little boy. And he was driving this kind of a blacked out Dodge Ram truck. It was bright red. And it was totally tinted out. And that's what Michael was, open bed truck. And that's what Michael was driving to the studio. And he would just put Prince in a seat next to him. And he would just walk into the studio with Prince in hand. And Prince was maybe a year old, maybe 18 months. I don't know, a toddler just wearing a diaper, fuzzy head, you know? And Michael just walk in and, you know, for a vocal session with no babysitter.
Wow.
So I had to put Prince on my knee with my arm around his belly. So I had his baby on my knee, on my left knee, and I had my right hand on the remote for the recorder. So I'm recording Michael Jackson's vocals. I got a baby in my left hand. And then, of course, not only that, I'm recording Michael, which is hard. I mean, recording him is really hard because he's fast. You don't want him to break flow. You're trying to keep his flow going. So I'm huffing and puffing. The kid is squirming around. A couple times he hit the button in the middle of a vocal and cut the vocal, you know. And then Michael's like, oh, Prince, oh, you're so silly, you know. And, you know, I'm like... And I'm smiling, having a great time to Michael, but in my mind, I'm going, oh, God, you know, how do I, damn baby is messing up my job. You know, that's how I was feeling at the time. I was getting so frustrated. But Michael knew that, and it was cracking him up. He knew I was sweating, you know, trying to keep up with the session and huffing and puffing, you know, babysitting and recording a vocal. He liked watching me go through that, you know, so.
That's an incredible story. Just to hear that's a very, very different Michael Jackson, the real Michael Jackson. That's a different Michael to what the media portray, like a guy just driving himself down to the studio in a ute with his son.
Yes.
That's incredible.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. I got another one. I got one more story. It's my favorite story. I've told this to a couple reporters, but they won't print it, I think, because it's a little risque, I guess. And I threatened to write it down on a blog post sometimes, but I'll tell it to you anyway because it's absolutely hilarious. It's my greatest Michael Jackson story, and it's kind of pertinent right now. Okay, so it's a bit risque. So I know some of his listeners are really sweet people, so I don't want to harm their ears. But I know you guys are going, yes, yes.
Yeah, so, yeah, absolutely.
We are ready.
So this was at the record plant, and I believe we were working on a place with no name, actually. And it was during that exact time, during those sessions. This was the time when Bill Clinton, the Monica Lewinsky dress was getting tested for Bill Clinton's DNA.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. You remember that?
Yes.
Yep.
Yep.
So it was huge news. And of course, everybody was waiting. The whole world was waiting for the DNA report. Is it Bill Clinton's, you know, on the dress? So I show up to the record plant early, you know, get ready for a session with Michael. And Michael's already there. I'm like, oh my God, I can't believe Michael Jackson beat me to the studio. I feel like an idiot, right? So I'm like, oh my gosh. So I walk in the studio and Michael is walking right at me. He goes, CJ, you won't believe it. What just happened? I'm like, yeah. He goes, Bill Clinton has dressed the DNA. It's his DNA. It's for real. And he's all excited. I mean, he's like, oh my gosh, you know, and he's just beside himself. And he's looking at me and like I should respond, you know, and I'm like, and of course, I already had my views about it. It was already in the news for weeks or months at a time. He was getting impeached or this other stuff, you know, and I go, Michael, I know all this mayhem over a lousy blowjob. And then Michael doesn't like hearing bad words. I forgot, you know. But I was incensed because I was like, all this stupidity over this, you know. And so when I said that Michael hit the ground, he screamed out loud, a blood-curdling scream. And he was on the carpet. He fell to his knees and put his face in his hands right into the carpet and screamed out loud in laughter. So he was like full on boisterous, huge ha ha's. And so he's there right at my feet, down in the carpet, laughing. And I'm standing up and I'm thinking I'm fired.
It's all over. And
I throw up my hands and I'm looking down at Michael Jackson, you know, crying passively. And I'm like, oh, CJ, you blew it. You know, that was a mistake because I get too comfortable sometimes with people. And you know, I just, you know, I do what I do. I'm who I am. So he gets up slowly and he's, oh my God. He's like that. And I'm like, Michael, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to say that. And he's going, no, that was so funny. So, and then he's walking away. Laughing, wiping, he's crying. He was laughing, wiping his face, and he walks into the lounge and closes the door. And I'm like, okay, you know, I didn't feel I was like, he didn't let me off the hook. I felt like I'm fired anyway. You know, he's going to be nice to me. And then in 2 hours, I'm going to call from the manager and I'm out, you know. So I waited. And a couple hours later, I didn't get the call. And then we kept working and then we worked for a few more months. So I didn't get fired, you know, but he thought I gave him a big belly laugh, though. He thought that was hilarious.
What a story.
That's amazing.
Yeah. Very funny.
He was friends with the Clintons. There's some great shots of Bill meeting Michael's kids and hanging out with Michael.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, then it's come full circle, hasn't it?
Yeah. You know,
but I guess he was excited about that news because, you know, I mean, it wasn't him, you know, and it was very sensationalist, you know, it was very, I should say, sensational. And it was, you know, huge, epic news, you know, everybody was waiting for this. You know, who doesn't like to hear a test result like that, you know? I mean, that was
exactly, yeah.
Ridiculous news and ridiculous amount of time spent on it, on the news cycle. And it was just ridiculousness. So I was incensed by it, but obviously, you know, it's hilarious and it's a sad fact of how it turned out, you know, but it was comedy at the time. It certainly was.
Mm-hmm.
That was a terrific, terrific story. Thank you.
You bet. Yeah. It's my favorite.
Love it.
Yeah. Other little things, you know, I mean, he wasn't very conversational, so to speak, unless it was at the moment. And so he was a pretty private guy. You know, I got that from him right away. I kind of felt that Michael Jackson was kind of an alone guy, but happy with it. You know, like, yeah. like, like, yeah, like, I mean, his definitely, I think his one of his favorite things to do was to be in the studio because he was animated there. I mean, he was somebody else in a way in the studio sometimes. He was just kind of sweet, laughing, fun, kind of not worried about people, you know? So when I saw him like that, I tried to help him with that as much as possible. Like, I don't have any photos with Michael, and I wish I did, you know? But I never asked him because everybody was asking him for photos. Everybody.
Yeah.
You know? And
he actually probably appreciated that.
Yeah.
Man, I would like to think he did. And I would like to think I got the job because I never jocked him for stuff like that, you know?
But the thing is, you might not have any photos with him, but you've got music with him.
That's the one, too. That's the one.
This is Rob Hoffman, studio musician and engineer with Michael Jackson, and you're listening to the MJ Cast.
I did introduce one little story I have with Brandy. I had recorded Brandy some months before, and she was, I'm sorry, you know, guys, I'm just coming up with these stories randomly, so I they're not.
Please don't apologize. We love it. Okay.
That's all good.
She I had ran into her at the front desk at the record plant, and she knew Michael was there, and she knew I was recording Michael, and she had never met Michael, and she walked up to me like a fan, wide-eyed. Oh my God, you got to introduce me to Michael. Can you introduce me to Michael, please? I'm like, oh my gosh. I'm like, first of all, it's her, and I want to keep working with her. Yes. So I'm like, because anybody else, I'd say no, you know, because I'm also there catching stuff for Michael for him not to get bugged. You know, it's kind of what I do also, right? So, but now I'm like trapped. I'm like, okay, it's Brandy, and maybe Michael would want to know. I justified it like that.
Yeah.
So I was like, I rarely knock on his lounge door. So I knocked on his lounge door, and he opened it up. And I said, Michael, Brandy's out here, just wants to meet you. She's just desperately wants to meet you. She won't leave me alone. And he's going, oh my gosh, but I'm so stinky. And he meant that in the real way. Because when he gets in the studio, he's like us. I can tell that he's just rolling out of bed, putting on the t-shirt he had on the chair, throwing on some shoes with no socks, going to the studio. He did that sometimes. So he had on, I mean, Michael, you know, sometimes he needed a shower sometimes, guys. Okay. And he was like, oh my gosh. And he knew it too. So he was like, oh, I'm not, you know, he was like, he wasn't together, you know, but he said, okay, anyway, you know? And so see, he had this wrinkled up old t-shirt on. He'd probably been wearing it for 3 or 4 days, you know, and no socks, penny loafers, and some, you know, just some regular old pants that he'd probably been wearing. Cause he was in kind of in work mode, you know, get up, go to the studio, go home, sleep, get up, you know how we do that. You know, we're just like, you know.
Oh yeah.
And so I showed her to his door, and he invited her in, and they chatted for a couple hours, but he was so sweet. You know, he was like, he didn't care, guys. You know what I'm saying? So he wasn't that much of a perfectionist for his own. I don't have the right word for it, but he was more sacrificial in his time with people than he was compared for himself. Mm. Like he could have said, no, I'm not ready, or I need to take a bath in the sink, or whatever he needs to do. You know, he would just like, yeah, you know, I mean, so I always thought that was a little thing that I liked about him, that he accommodated anybody that wanted to talk to him.
I want to hear the story of Brandy now. She's like, oh, the first time I met Michael Jackson, he didn't smell too good.
I bet you she didn't even notice, because she was like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. She probably didn't even care, you know.
Out of that meeting, they did little bits of work together. He did some amazing background vocals on one of her tracks called It's Not Worth It.
Yep. Oh, that's sweet.
Yeah, so nice job. Thanks.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. She was a sweet person too. I really liked her.
And some great stuff in her catalog too.
Oh, yeah. She was great.
And I think she did backing vocals on one of Michael's songs, didn't she, on Invincible?
Was it Unbreakable, I think?
Yeah, I think she's Unbreakable, I think. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Mm. Oh, that's good to know.
Yeah.
Oh, fantastic. Like to think I had a little something to do with that.
I would think so. Definitely. There you go. Yep. So thank you for introducing and asking Michael.
Yes.
So what are you up to? What are you up to these days?
Well, I'm primarily making my own music right now. I'm not doing a whole lot of outside production work. I'm just only because I just want to. I'm feeling very creative. I'm also working on opening a restaurant in Bangkok, Thailand.
Wow! Awesome.
Really?
Of all places. Yeah, I spent a lot of time there last year, about 6-7 months. I got a couple friends out there that have been out there a long time. I got some other friends that are moving out there, and we're starting a restaurant. So I'm going to do something really crazy and move to Bangkok and run a restaurant, barbecue.
Awesome.
That is awesome.
Congratulations. I hope it goes really well.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm going to keep making music like crazy. We're going to have a little, you know, little setup there. And I'm getting back to fun. You know, I'm at a point in my life where I just want to have fun with music. I don't want to work too hard anymore.
Yeah.
On music, because the more music I work on, the less I work on my own. I mean, other people's stuff. And when I work on music, I go all in. I can't help it. I'm like, it's like if I'm working with Michael, it's the same working with anybody else. I fully invest my spirit into anybody's music. So I have to be careful on whose music I spend time on. So I'm taking that mojo right now and basically using on being creative, if you know what I mean. I can't stop doing that. I feel like being a musician more right now than fiddling around with software and knobs and things like that.
Yeah, yeah.
Nice. That's what I'm, yeah.
So do you have any future plans to release like when is the new album going to come out, or, you know, do you have any,
my record?
Yeah, your record.
Well, to release, I definitely am going to do that. So I like to call, engineers sometimes make music and they make terrible music, you know? So sometimes I'm reticent to, because so many people know me as an engineer and not as a musician. So I have to get past that stigma, but I will be probably doing an EP maybe next year. I have about 3 songs that I really enjoy. I'd like to get a couple more.
Yeah,
and get a couple of my friends in on it. But probably around this time next year, I'll have an EP together.
Fantastic.
So do you feel like you work more like Quincy or more like Michael?
I work more like Michael. I do, because I'm not, nobody's Quincy. You know what I mean? And Quincy is like, Quincy's got that thing where there's no process between his thought and finishing. Mm-hmm. You know, Quincy knows what it's going to be before Quincy even knows. You know, his mind is made up before he records. So when Quincy records, it's just work, and then you finish. Yeah. So it's already in his mind. With Michael, it's a lot of people would say, "Oh, it's Michael's vision." Michael's vision wasn't set; it was a vision that he followed. He followed vision, not a vision. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
No one really knows how their stuff's going to turn out, you know, except maybe Quincy. So that's what I was getting to with that. I mean, Quincy's such a musical, magical beast in that aspect of being, you know, playing with Miles and Ray Charles and being able to score an orchestra, that kind of stuff, you know, that kind of level. Bananas.
CJ, we've got a question for you that we ask all special guests that come on the show. And it's a question that might be a little bit of a curveball for you, but sure. I'd like to know what you think about how Michael Jackson should be remembered.
Oh, that's a good question. Ooh. Well, just enjoy the songs. That is it. I mean, what else should there be? As oversimple as that may seem and as disappointing that answer might be, really, I think Michael would say the same thing. So, I mean, if all you had were his songs, wouldn't that be enough? You know?
Yep.
Yeah.
You know, and then on the next level, we have his lyrics. And then the next level of that, if you add up everything he sings about, you can tell that there's a thing that he's into, and it's love, and it's just everybody being cool to each other. And, you know, so I think on that, I don't think he can help being remembered that way.
Mm.
So I think he's going to be fine. As far as people who think of him negatively, I think they'll fall by the wayside in time.
Yeah.
I have, you know, famous friends and wealthy friends and things like that. When you start getting up to the point of the pyramid with your power, the people knocking you down, it just increases exponentially.
Mm.
So for the size of artist that Michael was, the size of the crap he gets is a ratio that's directly involved, and it's the same for everybody. The bigger and more hardcore you get, just the more you're going to get, you know, that thing from that negativity. So I think Michael will survive all that easy. I think he already has. I don't think it's an issue, you know. Just people tend to like sensationalistic news. And also, I'm really pissed off at the people who work for him, that they go after him. I don't like the detractors. As a matter of fact, when I was working with him, I thought his entourage, like when I was working with him in 95 with Delana, his entourage was huge. Mm. Must have been 7 people. You know, well, I felt the entourage was a bigger problem. You know, I felt some of the you know, when you hire all kinds of people you don't know, you're going to get into some issues. So I think Michael got an unfair shake from people that he had to be, had to trust. Yeah. Michael had trust issues, obviously. I mean, what could he do? I mean, he had to play games and find out what people were all about. So I think maybe some of the lengths he had to go to find trust got him in trouble, possibly. I don't know. Maybe some of the people he hired weren't who they said they were, but, you know, he has to hire and fire quickly. So you get what you get, you know?
Yeah.
But I think Michael will be remembered for one thing, and that's the music.
Yeah.
I think that is a very, very good answer. I mean, I think if people would, if throughout his career, if people would have just paid attention to the music and not paid too much attention to his personal life, I think things would have went a lot better for him, you know, as far, you know, later on in life. So,
So
good answer.
Thank you. Yeah, he would say the same thing. I mean, he put all his effort into it. I mean, he made videos and, you know, got invested in films and things like that. But Michael's medium was the song. So he would say that. He would say, just listen to my music. Don't listen to anything else. Just listen to the songs, you know. And everything he's about is in there.
Well, CJ, I think we're definitely getting to the end of our show today, and I'd like to say thank you very much for coming on the MJ Cast. It's really been amazing. One of the things that Q and I love to do is to have people on that worked with Michael Jackson in a creative sense. We feel it's a very important thing to document and capture those stories. Mm-hmm. So thank you very much for being a part of what we did.
Oh, it was my pleasure. It's a lot of fun, and thanks for reaching the cobwebs in my mind. I knocked a few out. That's pretty cool. Thank you. I feel a little lighter. Yeah.
So, CJ, where can people sort of find you online?
Well, you can go to my Facebook and just friend me up at my Facebook. I'm a little bit off the grid. I'm on computers so much that I have to be a little careful. So if people don't see me on Facebook for a week at a time, don't be discouraged. I tend to go MIA on Facebook for 4 or 5 days at a time, but that's where you can reach me. So just go to CJ DeVillar or Songworks or whatever and friend me. And I'm there with all my recording buds. A lot of people that work with Michael are on there. So there's some cross-friending going on. There's some more Michael Jackson people that I chat with occasionally.
Awesome. Yep, we'll pop links for that in the show notes indeed.
Yeah, for reals.
Cool. And Jankins, where can people find you and your podcast, Moonwalk Talks, online?
Moonwalk Talks is on every podcast thing that you, whatever podcast thing you use, it's most likely on there. Or you go to moonwalktalks.com. You can follow me at Jankins with two I's, because I changed it from at Who Jankins. And it's because somebody has Jankins and they don't even tweet.
Oh, that's.
Yeah,
I hate those.
They like made it in like 2009 and won't give it up. So I'm just like, I can't even get a hold of anybody. Yeah, it's annoying. So yeah, Jankins with two eyes. I'm on everything: Instagram, SoundCloud, all that fun stuff. Yeah,
you're good about it. I can't. Yeah. You know, I'm on the computer so much that it's like to be on it again. Oh my gosh, I can't do it.
Yeah.
Besides, I live at the beach. I got to go down to the beach, right? What am I going to do?
Oh yeah. Why would you be on the computer if you could be at the beach?
Or Thank Disneyland. You. Or Disneyland.
Okay, there you go. Even better.
And, of course, people can find us at themjcast.com. We also are across all the podcast applications, so just find your podcast application of choice and search for The MJ Cast. We're across Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram as The MJ Cast, and we're over at Tumblr as well. And we love your emails. So we look forward to you guys listening out there, sending your feedback across social media or email us. TheMJCast@iCloud.com is how you can reach us.
That's it. And guys, if you want to learn a little bit more about CJ DeVilla's work with Michael Jackson, especially on Blue Gangsta and A Place With No Name, you can pick up Damien Shield's excellent book, Escape Origins. There's some great interview material in there between Damien and CJ. So, yeah, I really enjoyed that book, CJ. I got to say, that was the first time I'd actually, you know, heard about your work with Michael, and it was fantastic.
Yeah, I didn't expect Damien to go so deep. And he asked some great questions, and he talked about some of the interviews he had with some other some other engineers, and boy, he went deep and he did an awesome job. So yeah, I agree with you. I recommend it.
Fantastic. Yeah. All right. Well, Moonwalkers and MJ fam, hope you guys have a great fortnight ahead. Thank you very much for tuning in again to the MJ cast, and make sure to keep Michaeling.
Michael on.
Cheers, fellas.
MJCast.